Hi friends. So ever since my conversation with Roger Cohen from the New York Times in Greece, and since showing some of it on the internet, I've been flooded by comments by both lay people and by physicists, and particularly quantum physicists, basically saying that quantum consciousness, or what I say about quantum consciousness, is basically mumbo jumbo, makes no sense, pseudoscience, etc., etc. So I think Roger Cohen opened up a can of worms in terms of resurrecting the controversy. But let's look at this a little bit, okay? What is a quantum? Ask any physicist and they'll tell you that a quantum is the smallest unit in which waves of energy, and I would add information, are emitted or absorbed. Okay, the smallest unit in which waves of energy are exchanged. So we can think of a quantum of light as a photon, quantum of electricity as an electron, a quantum of gravity, if there's such a thing as a virtual graviton. So then let's ask ourselves, what is a thought? And I would suggest to you that a thought is the smallest unit of energy and information in which ideas are exchanged and absorbed. Idea, thought, energy, information, smallest unit of information and energy in which waves are emitted or absorbed. So let's take the thought, I'm going to wiggle my toes. So that thought has energy, otherwise my toes wouldn't wiggle. It also has information. Wiggling toes is different than, say, going swimming, information. And that one little thought is an unit of energy and information that triggers a biological response. Okay? So what's the difference between thought and a quantum event? They're both units of energy and information in which exchange occurs. So this idea that thoughts are similar to quantum particles is actually getting a lot of attention, and it has been proposed by lots of scientists and philosophers. Okay, one of the key similarities between thoughts and quantum particles is that they both exist in a superposition of states. This means that a thought can exist as many different possibilities at the same time until it is observed or measured. This is similar to how a quantum particle can exist in multiple positions or states at the same time. Another similarity between thoughts and quantum particles is that they're both non-local. That means you can't find a location in space-time for them. This means that they can be interconnected and interact with each other even if they are separated by large distances. This is similar to how quantum particles can be entangled, and that means that they are linked together in such a way that they share the same fate, even if they are separated by a long or large distance. Some proponents of quantum consciousness believe that these similarities suggest that thoughts may be made up of quantum particles, or that they may interact with quantum particles in some way. They believe that this could explain some of the mysteries of consciousness, such as how we are able to have subjective experiences and how we are able to interact with the world around us. So there you are. Now, if a thought and a neural network and the transmission electrochemically along nerves triggers a physiological response, then the thought, the neural network, the biological response, the biology itself, and the perceptual activity that goes with it have to be entangled as a unified process in a single reality. And that, my friends, is quantum consciousness. Thanks for helping me expand this conversation. Particularly thanks to Roger Cohen, who initiated this whole conversation in a very lively sort of Q&A that we had a couple of days ago. Let me know your thoughts.